رسول الله طال بي الحنين.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل أعوذ برب الناس، ملك الناس، إله الناس، من شر الوسواس الخناس، الذي يوسوس في صدور الناس من الجنة والناس. صدق الله العظيم. This is Surah Nas, and this is the last chapter of the Holy Quran. And Surah Nas was revealed with Surah Al-Falaq, and these two surahs are given a combined name, Mu'awwizatain. And these surahs were revealed on Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, when he was suffering from a magical spell which was done by a Jew whose name was Labid bin Asam. He successfully got the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him's comb and some of his hair, and he tied them in a thread, and he made 11 knots in it, and he blew the words of magic on those knots. In Surah Al-Falaq, Allah mentioned magicians with the word annafathat fil uqad, blowers on the knots, because blowing on knots is a very important part of magic. And after that, Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, started suffering from this magic, because the messengers of Allah are also subjected to humanly weaknesses. So Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, started forgetting things, and he used to ask the other people whether he has done that thing or not. But the revelations were in the protection of Allah, because Allah himself has taken the responsibility of the protection of his book. And after a few days, Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, was informed about the situation in his dream. The Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, dreamt that two men were standing near him. One was standing near his head and the other one was standing near his feet. One of them asked the other, "What happened to this man?" The other replied, "He is suffering from magic." The first one asked, "Where is that stuff on which the magic is done?" So the other informed that it is lying in the well of Zarwan. And when Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, woke up, he was inspired by Allah that you should take out that stuff on which the magic is done. And then Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, also received Surah Al-Falaq and Surah Al-Nas. There are 11 verses in these two surahs, and Allah instructed the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, to recite one verse from the surah and untie one knot. When you will complete the recitation of 11 verses and all the 11 knots will be untied, you will come out from the influence of this magic. So this is the background of these surahs briefly. But this surah basically talks about Allah's relationship with humankind, and Allah has mentioned three important aspects of it. The surah says, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ مَلِكِ النَّاسِ إِلَهِ النَّاسِ. رَبِّ النَّاسِ means the Lord of mankind. The word Rabb is mentioned in many parts of the Holy Quran, and this word also occurs in Surah Al-Fatiha. And the Rabb means the nurturer, the provider, the one who takes care of all the necessities of his creation. So Allah is Rabbin Nas. It means that Allah is the nurturer of mankind. Whatever they need, Allah provides them. But in this surah, Allah is not talking about the physical needs like food, drink or something like that. But Allah is talking about the spiritual needs of mankind. They are also fulfilled only by Allah. And over here, Allah talks about the protection of mankind from evil. Only Allah can protect us from that evil, and the surah is ordering us to seek refuge with Allah against all evils. The second word is Malikin Nas, king of mankind. It means that Allah is the king of mankind. The supreme most authority over mankind is none other than Allah. All other authorities come after Allah's authority. No one has more authority and right on mankind than Allah, because He is the creator and He is the provider. And then Allah says, Ilahin Nas, Allah is the only God for mankind. Because when this verse can also be the result of the previous two verses, that when Allah created us, when Allah maintained us, and when Allah is the supremest authority on us, so obviously only Allah will have the right to be worshipped by mankind. So these three aspects are mentioned about Allah's relationship with mankind in the surah. Another important thing which is mentioned in Surah An-Nas is the existence of Satan, Shaitan. But over here the word Shaitan doesn't occur. Allah has mentioned shaitan with the words al-waswas and al-khannas. The word al-waswas is derived from waswasa, and waswasa means an evil idea which is poured into the heart of mankind by shaitan very secretly. We don't feel that shaitan is working on us, but we just feel that some ideas are coming in our mind and we start following them. But if it is an evil idea, so that is from shaitan. Putting such evil ideas secretly is called waswasa, and that's why shaitan is named as waswas over here. And the word khannas means to appear and then to retreat. Shaitan first puts an evil idea into our heart, but when we are not tempted, when we reject that idea, shaitan retreats for a while and then he comes back again. When we again reject him, he again retreats for a while and then comes back again with the same idea, and he continues putting those evil ideas into our mind, into our heart, until we commit that sin. So that's why the surah is teaching us that whenever we feel that the shaitan is attacking on us, so we should immediately turn to Allah and seek his refuge. Because when we will come in the refuge of Allah, shaitan cannot misguide us. Allah has repeatedly mentioned and reminded us in the Holy Quran that shaitan is an enemy for mankind. The Holy Quran says, "Inna shaytana lakum aduwwum mubeen." Indeed, shaitan is your obvious enemy. At another place, the Holy Quran says, "Inna shaytana lakum aduwwun fattakhidhuhu aduwwa." Indeed, shaitan is your enemy, so treat him like an enemy. And in the last verse of this surah, Allah says, "Min al-jinnati wan nas." We can interpret this verse in two different ways. We can say that over here Allah is saying that as the evil ideas are given to us by jinnat, similarly the evil ideas are also given to us by other mankind. Because shaitan is originally a jinn, and there are many jinnat who are the agents of shaitan, and they put evil ideas into the hearts of mankind. So shayateen are amongst jinnat, but similarly there are people among mankind who are the agents of shaitan, and they work for shaitan, and they misguide people and they put evil ideas into their mind as well. So we should seek refuge with Allah against both kinds of shayateen, whether they are from jinnat or from humankind. And we can also say that shaitan, though he is originally a jinn and he remains invisible, but sometime he appears in the human form. As we know that he appeared in the human form when the Quraysh were going to decide something about Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, in Darun Nadwa, and he attended that meeting in the human form. Similarly, it is reported that Shaitan was with Abu Jahl in the human form before Battle of Badr, but when he saw that Angel Jibrail was coming down with the forces of angels, he said, "Inni ara ma la tarawna, inni akhafu Allah." I can see the creatures, you can't see them, and he ran away from there. So we need to remain alert in both cases, whether the idea is given from inside, from jinnat, or the idea is given to us by other mankind. There are many things Muslims need to learn from this surah today. First of all, we learn from this surah that Allah is our Rabb. So whenever we need something, we should turn to Allah and seek only Allah's support. We usually ask Allah only for our worldly things, for our physical needs, like we ask Allah for wealth and health and fame and all other things which are related to our physical life. But at the same time, the believers should ask Allah for the fulfillment of their spiritual needs. Like they should ask Allah for the forgiveness of their sins. They should ask Allah to strengthen their faith. The verses in the Holy Quran teach us mostly the du'as and the prayers which are related to our spiritual needs. Like Quran says, "Rabbana la tuzigh qulubana ba'da idh hadaytana." Like, "Oh Allah, please do not divert us from the path of Iman and strengthen our faith." Similarly, we should ask Allah to give strength to fight against shayateen. These are our spiritual needs and only Allah can fulfill them. Similarly, when we learn that Allah is the king of mankind, so Malik and king is authority, the greatest authority, and the authorities are to be obeyed and authorities are to be respected. So we should respect Allah's authority and we should give obedience to Allah, and we should never follow any other authority in the disobedience of God, because no one has more authority on us than God. He is the King of all kings. And similarly, Allah is our Ilah. He is the only one who deserves to be worshipped. So we should worship Allah as much as possible for us. And there is a reminder in the surah that shaitan is always after us. And in other parts of the Quran, Allah has mentioned that shaitan says that he will attack mankind from their front, from their back, from their right and from their left. He attempts in all different ways. So we need to remain alert from the evil ideas of shaitan. And whenever we feel that he is attacking us, we should turn to Allah and seek His refuge. This is the only way we can remain safe from His attacks. And fighting against shaitan is known as a spiritual jihad. And according to some riwayat, this is the greater of all jihads. And we have to remember that the evil ideas can come within ourselves, like shaitan can put the evil ideas secretly. And these ideas can also be given to us by other people. So what is the criteria? How can we judge that this idea which is given to us is from shaitan or from the agents of shaitan? The simple criteria is that if the idea is contrary to the teachings of the Quran and Sunnah, we should understand that it is from shaitan and we should reject it and we should resist and we should fight against it. This is a spiritual jihad we need to continue throughout in our life. May Allah save us from the attacks of shaitan and may Allah enable us to follow the path of Allah throughout our life. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.